don't know, I'll give you the short version. I was born in Warrandyte, grew up in Warrandyte, over the hill, and, you know, grew up with, both of my parents were potters, you know, their contemporaries and my contemporaries, you know, they were, my friends were the children of my parents' contemporaries. So my parents' contemporaries were people like Ian King, Graham King, all the potters from Potter's Cottage, and my parents were two of the founding members of Potter's Cottage. So, you know, the short version was growing up in Warrandyte was really an extraordinary experience because as children we didn't question it, but only in retrospect I see that when you grow up with parents, adults, who are just doing what they do, they love what they do, they're just doing what they do, whether they're painters or filmmakers or potters. You know, Warrandyte in those days was a long way away from anywhere, it seemed. And, you know, we, the children of those parents, we just knew that you could just do whatever you wanted with your lives. So it was only when I grew up and I just couldn't understand why other people didn't do that too, that I realised it was my upbringing. It was my, in the environment that I grew up in that has allowed me, you know, to just do what I want to do. And it's a real privilege. So that's up to about 16 years old. That was that bit. So then I became friends with the Knoxes here in Eltham, because Margot Knox started a school called she was one of the beginners, called, what was it called? Hurstbridge, no, what's it called? Diamond Creek Tech. I'm only saying that because there are some people here who went to that school. And it was an alternative school. And all of us kids who didn't fit into normal schools went to that school, which was great. And we became like the experiment. La Trobe Uni used to use us kind of like their experimental children. And it was great because in what was the equivalent of Form 5 and 6 when you're supposed to be doing serious stuff, we were just having a great time. And so that, you know, then that introduced me to this whole Eltham community. You know, Damien's here, Damien Skipper, who lives here, and so, you know, friends of Montsalvat, mucking about here, riding bikes between Warrandyte and Eltham, you know, then later motorbikes, and, you know, as a group of kids, that was a brilliant, you know, next stage, like the teenage up, you know, the teenage part. And one of the things I really, really thank Margot and Alistair for was their whole way of being around how you live your life. And the thing that I remember from Margot and Alistair was, you know, building houses. You know, people should just build their own houses. And people should dig the dirt out of the ground and make mud bricks and go to Wheel and the Wreckers and get some great bits of wood or some trusses and build their houses. And husbands and wives should build them together, and kids should be building them too. So for me, when I was 19, you know, I built a house with McGregor Knox, who was my partner at the time, and as a stepping stone for life, to actually know, because before that I didn't know this, but to know that you can build your own house was just mind-blowing. You know, literally dig the dirt and, you know, put up things, and it was amazing. So that kind of beginning up to, you know, maybe 20 years old was an extraordinary unfolding of what's possible for a human being. And so that was kind of how it was. And then I lived in the city and I was a yodeling, whip-cracking cowgirl. And that was how I made my living for a while. It was the only real job I've ever had. And, you know, lived in St Kilda and practiced my whip-cracking in the backyard of, you know, behind the flats, and it's quite painful learning to crack a whip, because until you get it handled, you whip yourself. It's not deliberate, but it's a very St Kilda thing to do. And our friends, a lot of people had come from Eltham and Warrandyte, and we all lived in St Kilda and Fitzroy, and, you know, it was really an extraordinary time. So that was a really lovely time too. So then I stopped being a yodeling, whip-cracking cowgirl because I didn't like going to work. That was like going to work. You know, you had to be there. People expected you to be there in the evening because there was a show that was going on. So That was when I started to make things out of clay, seriously. And this slide here, even though it's a pretty awful picture, and I apologise, is kind of, we're now in my mid-20s, and the National Gallery of Victoria had asked me to make a sculpture for the front moat of the gallery, and essentially I just nearly freaked out, because I'd gone from being a studio potter, you know, working by myself with some clay in my studio by myself, no trouble to anyone mostly, and suddenly I had this opportunity to make a sculpture for the front moat of the gallery, and I just thought, this is going to ruin my life, because I had no background. So luckily, fortunately, I did a course called the Forum. It's now called the Landmark Forum. But the bottom line about doing that course was that I got to see that I could choose. I could choose yes or no. I could choose yes and take it on and just, you know, create what's possible out of this opportunity. Or I could authentically say no. You know, thanks very much for the opportunity, but actually no, I'm going back to my pottery, which I love. So when I got that I could choose that, then I chose yes. And it was not even a steep, it was a straight up learning curve, if that's possible, straight up. And so this sculpture is called The Farmer, and this was my first test sculpture. So it's quite tall, it's about, I don't know how tall, 8 foot tall in the old language, and essentially what I was doing was looking to see how the tiles, you know, space bar, we'll just keep that moving. So essentially, you know, I'm painting on the tiles, I'm cutting them up. Losing control. Sorry. You might have to sit there and do that. Can we go back? Anyway.
Here we go.
So the bottom line, if you have a look at that, this is great. So you can see how kind of crudely cut up the tiles are. It's very crude. It worked okay. You know, I was thinking about Gaudi and that sort of person, and thinking, well, he did that, so that works. That's valid. But then, so if we could have the next slide, thanks. And the next one, we'll get to Angel. So then, even though that, I apologise for the quality of that, but essentially, so that's 10 metres high, that sculpture, and essentially what we discovered, I worked with a team of people, fabulous team of people, and none of us knew what we were doing, but the kinds of skills that we brought to this project were things like dressmaking skills. So, you know, Sally Mill, who is a friend of mine, worked on the project, my right-hand woman, you know, she brought dressmaking skills, which means how do you get, a hard object to lie down flat on a curvy object, which meant that then just by sheer, it's kind of logical, if you cut them up more, each tile becomes more, it's going to lie down more. So anyway, that took 3 years to make, but we're only going to take that long to look at it. Now, here we are. If we had less light, we'd have better pictures. But essentially, this is where Angel got moved 17 years later onto the riverbank, and it was so exciting. The whole thing had to be, renovated, really, like a building. So because she'd been standing in the moat of the National Gallery, which was damp for 17 years, all that damp and all that sun and all that rain and all that stuff, she needed a bit of a reno. So, you know, we checked the whole thing and we took off any tiles that were loose and put them back on. And so she came back spick and span, and then we all had to learn, get the tickets to drive these bits of machinery, which was fantastic. We had lessons, and we got our tickets, so we can, if anybody needs us to drive a 30-foot high anything, you come to us. Okay, thanks. So this just gives you a feel for where it is. We're up on the scaffold and looking down the river. So, you know, it's a lovely spot. There's a whole story to the, you know, the moving of Angel, but we won't go into that. So we can. All right, so all the while, so Angel is painted ceramic panels. So if you imagine it's a painting on ceramic tiles, fired, and when it comes out of the kiln, it reads like a picture. These ones, so as I've gone along, I've discovered that you can buy beautiful tiles, you know, Bunnings, you know, or good tile shops, and you get these fantastic colours. So the work has become less painted panels and become more mosaic. And I may or may not say why I don't call myself a mosaic artist as we go along, but essentially what I'm interested in is the colour, the gorgeous colour of the ceramic, of the ceramics. These works are kinetic, so the one on the left is called Pussy, and I'll tell you about Pussy in a minute. And then we've got Paisley and Sun and the Moon, and this one is called Captain Kirk. And these three are kinetic in the most simple way. So they've got bearings here, that's a bearing. It's called a thrust bearing, because all the thrust goes down this. And that spins, these spin and those spin. In fact, our sculpture at Wayfarer, which is now in the Shire offices, also spins, so it's got that same technology. Now, Pussy on the left, this was when Jeff Kennett was in power, and Jeff Kennett, or we'll say Jeff, bought that sculpture to give to our Japanese friends, maybe in the city of Osaka, I think, because that's our sister city in Japan. And so they'd chosen it, they bought it, and its name was Pussy. And a letter came, a request from the Japanese, saying, would we mind changing the name of Pussy to Cat? So I thought about it for a minute. I thought that was okay, that's fair. So that's now Cat, also known as Pussy. Okay, thanks. So I had to think whether I was compromising anything for myself. This work's called Love Table. It's got maybe three or four panels. They're all separately painted. But I'm really just showing you have to... When you're working with tiles, which is a hard surface, to make it lie down and be like it's flexible and fluid and curvy and gorgeous, you have to just keep looking at what it needs to do to lie down flat. So this one's quite, you know, curvy, and so it's got lots of cuts in it to get it to do that. This is Ophelia, which is out South Gate. It's just been moved forward because she was standing there in front of that restaurant and driving them mad because she was taking up at least one table space. and I don't know if anybody has seen her recently before she was moved, but she had umbrellas poking her in the eye and they had stuck, you know, sticky tape on her. And she was pretty upset, she told me. So Ophelia was the face of Melbourne for 4 years, which is pretty special. And some of you might have seen her. If you used to come in from the international airport and there was a big cardboard cut out of her, I thought, yeah, that's the way we like our sculpture. So representing Melbourne. This is at Maribyrnong High Point Shopping Centre. This is called Family. And I was still quite young, so in my early 30s when I made that. And it was a great exercise in having a budget, which of course was not very much. I don't say of course, but they always are, not very much. And just trying to work out how can you give people value for money and also represent yourself whilst staying in the budget. So that was fun. So, you know, that's just part of, yeah, thanks. That's part of the things you have to think about. So this is obviously a ceramic piece. This is when I was working a lot in ceramic. So I'm showing you this one because this one's called Person Leaning on Nose. And if you go to the next one, so this is Portal to Another Time and Place. And the short story about Portal is that I made that as my entry into the Lempriere Award at Werribee Mansion, Werribee Park. And there came a point in my life where I started to think, I can't wait anymore for people to commission me to make large works. You know, I started to think, I will die waiting for somebody to ask me to do the next one. You know, and you start and you get a feel for it when you make large works, and you want to see them. So even though I had, you know, my ceramic piece in that exhibition, I always saw that one as a large piece. So I thought, well, here's my opportunity to blow some money and employ some friends and make the sculpture that I want to make. So this sculpture is 5 meters high, and if we go along... Oh, yes, okay. So it's just recently been sold to a private person, and this is us, so you can see, I think that's Kate on the top, and Lynn's here. Lynn, who works on my team with me, can ask Lynn about what it is to work with these projects. So we had the big scaffold and the generator, and had to have the umbrellas up because it got a bit sunny up the top. And, you know, sometimes you just have to do what you got to do. So there were just tiles that needed repairing or replacing, so we replaced them. And, yes. This is Lynn working. I like to have comfortable working experiences. Lying down is good. So lying down was the only way Lynn could get to the bottom of the sculpture. All right, thanks. That's me doing some dangerous angle grinding activity. Yes, thanks. In the studio. Yep. Helene, some of you might know Helene Paisley. So, you know, that's... I mean, I'm showing you the studio works because I have... it's really... It's lovely to be able to work on a group of work with a group of people that you love to work with and who also tell me that they love to do the work too, mostly. So, you know, we have... It's really good fun. It's good fun and it's hard work and it's all that stuff. But, you know, that's how it goes. Here we are. Bosom Woman. That is Bosom Woman. I think, what is that? A bit of cleaning. So cleaning probably before grouting. Looks like it. Yep, okay. Yes. Yep. Okay. So here they are in the truck. Now, if you ask a proper art mover to move an artwork, it's a pretty, you know, it's a serious business. Whereas I work with these guys from Artwork Transport, and they're brilliant, and they're careful, and they pack them into the truck, and they always get where they have to go, and they don't have to be supervised. Not supervised, but overpacked. You know? Okay, thanks. But sometimes you see that you can't tell what you're moving if it's overpacked. This is a neon work. This is another one of those. There are a few things in my life where I do something because I can't wait for somebody to ask me. So this is a neon work, and I've been dying to do a neon work forever. So this is it being made. And thanks. This is it on. And you'll see, if you go on, you'll see... Sorry, but if we... I won't say that thing about light, but if we had less light, we'd have better pictures. Next, yeah. So that kind of shows you, it's really, the quality of the neon is quite delicious. It's just yummy. And so the perspex is actually like mirror perspex, so it reflects it, and it's just delicious. So, yeah, thanks. Now, the other thing I wanted to do was make some inflatable sculptures. So... Not that I'm planning on dying anytime soon, but I get a bit impatient. So this was made, this was part of, I think it was called the Dream Festival, and it was down on the river, I say the river, the Yarra, our river, and there are a whole bunch of them. And anyway, so I borrowed this one. Yeah, thanks. But, you know, it's just fun to play. Yeah, thanks. So the mirror, now... The mirror has really started to kick in with my work now. And for a while there, I thought mirror was just going to be too much. I thought, mirror, it's going to be a bad move. It's going to be, you know, people will just go, no, mirror. That's the mirror phase. It's not right. But the more I started to use mirror, the more I saw it's so marvellous. Especially plain mirror, actually, because it just picks up everything. It picks up everything that's going on. And it just adds a whole new dimension to it. So this is Phoenix. And Phoenix I designed just after my mum had died.
3 years ago, and it really, anyway, it's just kind of a reflection of her. This is, it looks a little bit mosaic-y, doesn't it? But I'm not going to call it mosaic. But it is mosaic. Okay, yes, thanks. Yeah. So, I love these because they look like that fabulous gallery. Where's that museum? Where is that?
Mm-hmm.
You'll know it. Somebody will know it. In Spain.
Bilbao.
Yeah. Bilbao. Yeah. I love that. And just the whole, you know, delicious. Okay, thanks. So here it is. So this is more of that shifting sculptures thing. My studio is at the top of a hill. This doesn't show you how steep it is, but it's quite steep. So we had to get it into the trailer in some mattresses and bring it down the hill. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, thanks. So here we are up on Cambridge Ground Road in Warrandyte. So I think it looks a bit worried, actually. And you missed all the crane stuff, but that's what happens. So here it is in its South Yarra. It's, it now lives in somebody's man-made dam, I believe. But anyway, that's one of those sculptures. Every now and again, you do one that you're really, really happy with, and that's one I'm really happy with. Yeah. Now, this one is called Sylvia, and that was actually my mum's name, so that's also related to my mum. That's a print, the thing on the right. So I've been working with Chrysalis Publishing and doing some etchings, sugar lift etchings, which are, it's a technique that Picasso used to use, which allows you to do a really loose gestural design on a piece of steel, and then it gets, you know, etched, and then it can hold a lot of ink. They're good fun. They're really fun. This is your sculpture. This is the what's it called? Wayfarer. What's it called? It's called Wayfarer. And anyway, that's now in the shy offices. Yeah, that's the back of it. Now that's called little. It's called Wall, and it's got glass doll's eyes, which I particularly love. Not everybody does. Okay, so that's another etching on the wall. And that's, so that's this mirror here. This one's all mirror at the back. This is all mirror. And then the tiles at the front. So it gives you this really nice contrast. Okay, thanks. That's a kinetic one as well. So that looks beautiful. Turning. Cheeky monkey. Kirsty at the front and Kate at the back. So, yep, that's in the studio. Because my studio is just a big glass box, it hasn't got any walls to speak of that aren't glass. So we have to use umbrellas sometimes because it gets a bit sunny in there. That's Ben Fasham, who shifts my work, fashions, and that's tape. This work's called Phoenix. Totem. Yep, thanks. Totem having a little fly. It's going, so that's now in front of the Moss Green Gallery. Yeah, thanks. Now this one's called Jade, and I have two galleries that represent me, and they both have said that green sculptures don't sell. And you know what? This sculpture hasn't sold. How bizarre is that? What's that about? Anyway, it's a beautiful sculpture, and all of us who know it love it. You know? I think they put the Moz on it.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
The image in the background, is it paint?
No, that's tile.
Tiles.
Yeah, tiles on the blue board. Yeah. And now these ones, there are three panels that I'm going to show you. These are beaded works made by women in Nepal, Nepalese women in Nepal that I've been working with, a group of us whiteys who've been working with our Nepalese friends, and the women that we've been working with are survivors of child trafficking. And one of their areas of expertise is beading. And so they make, I wanted to see if there was some way that I could, you know, work with them using my design. So they have done some beautiful work, and this is called Leaping Fish. It was kind of an experiment, like they all are. So I left them with the designs, and I left them with, you know, put green here and put this there. So this one has changed direction slightly, but you know, it's got a kind of vitality that has been added vitality. Yeah, thanks. And this one. What? Sorry.
Sorry, I just wanted to ask, did they stick on the beads or did they...
No, it's beaded, sewn on. Yeah. And I'd like to make some, you know, jackets or something. I'm just not very, you know, clothesy, but I reckon they could do some really stunning things. But, you know, then I was talking before about, you know, I've learned a lot about myself because, you know, as a group of us, we went into Nepal and I noticed I start to be like, you know, the white, I call myself white trash, the white saviour. You know, you come in and you're going to help these poor people, and it's all very condescending and horrible when you tell the truth about yourself. And, you know, one of the ideas I had was to make an exhibition, make some sculptures with them. And I thought, how fantastic, you know, I could have women in Nepal that I work with, and we, you know, so it actually becomes a business that they're running. It's their business. So I'm thinking it's this great idea. And when I finally put the idea to them, you know, their beautiful faces were just like, you know, if they could have said it, they would have said, what are you thinking? Because they want to do, these women have had shit lives, you know. They've been trafficked. They have been sold into sex slavery. They've either escaped from brothels. You know, you can hardly even think about it because it's so awful. And they've either escaped or been rescued, and now they're safe. And they want to do beautiful things. You know, they want to do things that are really representative of them now at this stage of their lives. So this is the kind of thing that they want to do. And here I am coming along saying, you know, we could do fiberglassing and we could be cutting tiles. And they're like, no, you know, we don't want to do that. So I had to really see that what I think is a good idea is not necessarily their idea, their idea of a good idea. So, you know, I've learned a lot about myself and my well-meaning ways. And also, you know, you have to just calm down a bit. You know, I have to calm down and just really see what's possible for them. What do they want? What's their self-expression going to be? And, you know, even though I would say probably all these women are HIV positive, you know, they're well, they're healthy. The medicine now keeps people alive a long time and healthy. So, you know, they want to have, they're ready to design lives for themselves that are really extraordinary and representing who they are, because they are heroes and courageous and wonderful women. So, you know, this was just, you know, this is something I did with them. And
so, Deborah, what size are those?
They are, what's that, 30? Mm. About 30 round? Mm. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. So you can see this is like that other one you asked about. So this is the mirror and tiles on a blue board. Yep. Kate, this is called Ned Kelly, up on the pedestal, and Kate's sister. Artist's impression, of course. This is Rufus. I have a dog who's a dachshund, long-haired dachshund, and he looks just like this, actually. Yeah, so studio, and so you get a feel for, the work, so what I was if you go to the next one. So this is the work, this is fiberglass. Mm-hmm. It's got aluminium armatures and steel, expanded mesh and fiberglass. And I used to send everything out to be fiberglass somewhere else, but in some ways it's easier to do it myself because then you can really look after the shape differently, you know, more mindfully. So I've learned a lot as we've gone along through life. So this is the Ship of Good Fortune, and also known as the Ship of Fools. But what I discovered is that people with the kind of money to buy this work do not want a sculpture called the Ship of Fools. They don't want to be represented by something that might look like a bit of an idiot. So, which is not my intention for it, because I just figure we're all fools on a ship, you know, the ship of life, and here we are, and off we go. So that's my take on it, but it's not everybody's take. So, and this work I made for Sculpture by the Sea in Sydney. Yeah, thank you. And that's back.
Gorgeous.
But, you know, one of the nice things about making the larger work is, you know, you can work on a larger scale. That's an obvious thing to say, isn't it? But what I mean is, let's say the back of it, you know, the back of that is a really lovely size, whereas if you make a small thing, it's lovely, but it has a different feel to it. So this is kind of like, it's a real boat, you know, and it's really going to go somewhere. And here it is at Cottesloe, because then it went across Australia to Cottesloe, Sculpture by the Sea in Cottesloe, and that's fun too. Thanks. This one's called Colt. Yep, thanks. This is called Silk Scarf. That's the back of her hair. That's dichroic glass, which changes colour as you look at it from different directions. It's quite very beautiful. This one is called, I called this one Monsieur Hulot, but because he's a little bit French looking, I think. Have there no French people here? You're going to take offence? He's up here, thanks. Here he is. I love him. He's a little bit supercilious, a little bit, you know. Thanks, yeah. And that's the back of him. And the great thing about, you know, three-dimensional work is that you can have every side, every aspect can look completely different. Thanks. I'll put them out of whack then. So this is one of Lynn's photos from the top of this sculpture, portal, the arched one. So I put that in because it's beautiful, because it's in the wrong spot. It's a good photo though, Lynn. So here we are. So Ophelia has been moved out of her in-the-way spot, right out into the front, and within about, you know, a day, somebody backed into it with a window washing thing, and we had to repair it straight up. So, but still, she's happy there, she tells me. It's good, isn't it? She's just one of the gang. She's hanging out there. Yeah. Oh. So that was in the 4 years when she was the face of Melbourne. And I will say, in inverted commas, I was lucky enough to have a flight on that, but I'm not very good in hot air balloons. I just wanted to jump out for the whole time. I had to hold myself in. But, you know, amazing privilege to have that. Now, I'm putting these in because these are two little models. When I'm working on a bigger work, not necessarily a small work, but on bigger works I make little models, so they're like, in the old language, 6 inches, you know, in length. And so I do lots and lots of them, and then I can just really muck about with them and, you know, see how they look and take photos. And so to do the bigger work, I always make a little something I can look at. This is called Alice. And I put this one in because this is aluminium. So it's just painted aluminium in a cross shape. And what's really lovely, also, I apologise, you can't really see it, but when you cut these slits out, and that you get shadow through onto this, and it gives you a whole, even though it's just flat surfaces, it's very, very simple. It really, you know, it's very dynamic, and every kind of facet has a different feel to it. Yeah. This is work I did with Warrandyte Primary School, because my son was there, so that was why we were there. And I just, my point is, okay, thanks. Even when I'm working with five-year-olds, I insist, I call it benevolent dictator, but sometimes it's not so benevolent. I insist that they do really excellent work, like really top-class work. So if I didn't say this was done by a five-year-old, you might not know that, because it's very, very thoughtful, very thoughtfully done, and we really take the time. So even though this is a kid's drawing, and I have faithfully, transferred it onto the board, when we put the tiles on, it's really, really thoughtfully done, and, I want kids to know and kids to be proud of the end result that, that they're part of. Yeah, thanks. But you can't go past kids' drawings, can you? I mean, I could steal any one of those drawings and say it's mine and I'd be very happy. Yeah, really, they're brilliant. Yeah, okay. So that's just that. This is another thing. This was part of Spring Racing Carnival. So I got to paint a rearing horse, and then somebody bought it and put it in their vineyard and called the vineyard, I think it's called Rearing Horse Vineyard. Okay, thanks. This is a little bronze. It's also about 6 inches high. And why I'm showing you the bronzes, they're just a few, is that I've learned a lot about patinas on bronze and how many different colours you can get. So if you go to the next one, they're just, and the next one. So that's the back of that one. So they're just, the patina is extraordinary. And not, thanks. So it's not like I do that work, but I work with the people at Meridian Foundry. These are the inflatables on the riverbank. So you can see Angel there in the background, and it was really quite fun. I don't think it was very well advertised, but there are a whole bunch of artists, and they were all on pontoons, and you walked on the pontoons, and it was really fun. So that's that. Yeah, thanks. This is another model. This is it's for another job, but I'm showing you this because I look at these works, these maquettes or models, and I think, imagine if that was an apartment block, and then you had 10-story high next side, and then, you could say, my apartment's in the eyeball. Or I've got the lips, or, you could really have some stunning buildings. I mean, I'm saying that could be stunning. Yeah, thanks. But, it's all made up. That's, the more I do this job, the more I realise how made up it is, which is very fun. Yeah. So here we are. So this is in Meridian Foundry. And this is a commission that I did for a family. The mother, the wife and mother, had died, and she was a huge supporter of me. And they thought the best way to represent her and her life was to have a marvellous, tombstone, memorial. So this is bronze, and I made it. I mean, I had never worked in this way before, but this plant was initially made out of wax. So I literally had, sheets of wax, which I'd heated up in my oven. So they'd been softened in the oven, and then I rolled them out. This is a kitchen. This is a woman's in the oven. And then I rolled them out with the rolling pin so that they're flat. And then I could cut them into leaf shapes. And wax is amazing because it's soft. You can model it and you can stick it together. It's like clay. It's probably as close to clay as any material. Anyway, so in the end, I had this fabulous wax plant, and then I took it to Meridian, and they carefully cut it up and numbered everything, and cast it, and then they stuck it all back together, welded it together. Mm. And then this is Peter, who is the king of patinering, and he's patinating it. So if you go to the next one, so he's spraying different chemical mixtures on there that produce different colours when they interact with the copper, or the bronze, should I say. So, you know, this is pretty marvellous. If you, you know, look at those colours, aren't they fabulous? So, yeah. Now, the other thing I was able to do was, this is concrete, so there's the lid of the grave and then there's the headstone. So I did a big clay, design. Then we poured the concrete in and we put Rio in so that when it was undone, you had these designs on it. So we keep going. So this is
gorgeous.
And into the concrete, I put some copper. So hopefully over time, it'll start to do some different reacting and look a less, you know, concrete. But it was pretty, it was an amazing opportunity, that one. Yeah. All right, so this, I better speed it up a bit. Don't know how far I am into this. I was working with the Victorian Opera, and how I got this job was I bound it up to, my mum and I were doing, singing opera in a day. I don't know if any of you have done it, but anyway, you can just go and sing an opera for a day. And with Richard Gill. And so I bound it up to Richard Gill in the lunch break. I said, Richard, I'd love to do a set for you. Now, he didn't know who I was, and he gave me one of those withering looks that people can give you, which is the go away, you silly old middle-aged woman look. And I was wearing my T-shirt that I bought from the, you know, opportunity shop. Anyway, luckily somebody else recognised me. So, you know, I got this fantastic job to make a set. Now, I'm showing you these pictures because I know nothing about making sets. I know nothing about how you present your ideas. I don't know any of that stuff. So I'm kind of... It was called the Parrot Factory. It was an opera for young people. And, you know, so this is me. This is my best attempt at showing it. So in the end, this was one of the final designs. And if you show the next one, that is the actual set. Now, how clever are they? So it's all cardboard. The whole opera went for, I don't know, I think it had 5 performances. It was in the Malt House, so it was a massive, like, you know, it was serious, but it was only short season. So this is that, and, you know, there were windows that open and close and things that go up and down. They're so clever. Yeah, next one. This is another set of mine, and then the next one is the actual set. So I was so thrilled to see that, you know, you can take a daggy old drawing like mine and it almost faithfully recreate it so that you get not a daggy old set design, you get a beautiful set design. So, thanks. And I even got to design the costumes, which was fun too. But, you know, it's amazing. So all those costumes were made for 5 performances. Unbelievable. Insane. Yeah. So this was a set that I... Well, what's it called? The curtain that comes in front. A curtain? A curtain. Yeah, we didn't put the curtain in, but I got to work on it. You can see my car in the background. So it's a massive painting done with spray paint, which is good fun. Yeah, this is Marley. Marley is... Well, it's nothing like Marley, but some of you might know Marley from the zoo. And this year is their 150th anniversary, and I'm working with... So Jo's a teacher and a friend, and she's come to work on Marley with me. If anybody else would like to work on Marley, please come and talk to me afterwards. So if you go to the next one, we're now... You know, she's been completely mosaic, and... So there are a whole series of Marleys. I think there are 100 of them being painted by artists and probably none mosaiced, but so just being treated creatively, and then they'll be put into Melbourne and put in the zoo and then auctioned, and that'll be the Marley project, which is pretty exciting. Yeah, thanks. So can you go back? Yeah, thanks. This one's called, what's he called? Big Kitty. Big Kitty. And Big Kitty's about this big, off the ground. And he's pretty naughty, he's pretty bad, but we love him. And so I'm now beginning to work with a bit of glass, and so these are some glass panels, they're just experimental, but you know, I have an idea about a whole wall of glass, see-through would be good, but I get a bit excited about the colour, so I forget that I want them see-through. So they're solid, and that last one. So that's four panels, and you know, just experimenting all the time, fucking about and playing, and you know.
So they painted?
No, they're not painted. That's coloured glass. So the glass is cut and fitted together, and it's fiddly. Mm. It's as fiddly as anything, but the end result's worth it. Mm. Yeah. I think that's the last one. Yeah. So that kind of takes us up to pretty well today.
That's
fantastic. Yeah, it's wonderful. Thanks. Sorry. Thanks, Deborah. Does anyone have any questions for Deborah?
Yeah. Where was your studio?
You
didn't have an open day.
So my studio's in Warrandyte, and I have it open, not open to everybody in the universe, but if somebody would like to come, you can give me a call. Yeah.
Now, Deborah, you obviously do impressive, large, joyous works, and I saw your exhibitions in the late 70s, which was incredibly joyous, which really impressed me. And that was at Conn's Cottage. And
wow, that's a long time ago.
It was a very long time ago.
Yeah.
And I still remember the faces.
Oh, wow.
And there was a beautiful the telephone box with the grill.
Yeah.
And the little vanity.
Yeah.
And
rubber
gorillas. I ummed and ahed about buying one. And I thought,
That's
fine. Going back to that exhibition, was that, did you say, your first?
Do you know what? I think it was my first. And I think that show, I seem to remember that we were all a bit perplexed about, or even worried maybe, about how people would take that work. Because the work that's being spoken about was, like, literally, you know, I made ceramic telephone boxes with rubber gorillas in them, and there were gorillas in tutus. So, you know, I went to toy shops and I bought Barbie outfits and I shoved gorillas into them. But, you know, they were ceramic as well, so it was kind of a mixture. But we had no idea. Because Potter's Cottage at that time was really, really kind of straightforward, if you know what I mean. You know, it was traditional pottery.
Have and you got a collection yourself in your life?
No. But what gave rise to that work was that my life still is a reaction to everything else. So, you know, if I, Potter's Cottage, you know, you had people who did sculptural stuff and people who did hand-built stuff and people who did earthy stuff and, you know, so that sort of 70s thing. So for me growing up, I was like, I'm not going to do any of that. I'm not doing that. You know? So if you're not doing that, then the question is, what are you going to do? So then I had to kind of create out of reaction, or what I was going to do. So that was some of the things. And, you know, that was kind of funky, and, you know, we were all hippies, so, you know, it was all kind of appropriate to the time.
But nevertheless, you've still got that theme running through your work, for me anyway.
Yeah.
That it's just a joyous, fun experience.
Yeah, great. Thanks. Sometimes it's not a very joyous experience making it. But hopefully the end result is. Sometimes I look at the faces and I go, oh, that's a bit of a grumpy face. Who's got a grumpy face? Yeah, so. Yeah, but the intention is to make work that is life-affirming and joyous. And, you know,
I don't want to bring anybody down, man. But you know, it's just like, what's the point? You don't. There's enough to bring us all down. So, thanks. Yeah.
How long does it take to complete a large work with all the timing and mosaic?
Oh, that's about how long's a piece of string. It depends. So Lynn's here. She can correct me because Lynn works with me. And I do a lot of walking around and talking about it. And Lynn does a lot of working. So if you just started something and you fiberglassed it and you tiled it and you grouted it, probably if you really just did it in time, you know, it'll take that sort of length of time. But if you have to go, okay, we have to get the shape right. You know, it's never straightforward. Now the colours. So let's say today Lynn and I have been working on a piece. And we have to look at how does that colour here go with this colour here. You know, we've got a very bright colour here and then we've got a soft head. How do you get those two things together? And you have to think about it. So you're thinking, is blue going to be the right colour? Is it green? Or is it, you know? So you have to do a lot of thinking and looking. And sometimes it's not obvious straight up. You know,
the actual practical process of something's preparing.
Well, look, some of it is. Some of the big swooshes are very straightforward because they're just big. You know, you just put it, you know the colours and you're putting them on, cutting them and putting them. And then the fiddly bits, sometimes, you know, if you have to get a bit that's this sort of a shape and you're cutting everything to fit, it's just like, oh, nightmare. You know? And you can't have sharp bits because you don't want small children to hurt themselves, you know, or adults. So I'm not being evasive, but it's kind of, you know, yeah, it's fiddly. It is. It always takes longer than we think. That's what I can tell you. And I will say, we'll get that done in a week. And Lynn will say, no, we won't. and she's always right. Yeah.
Putting the steel beads on things that I think was a fairly recent.
Legs?
Is that essentially to reduce the weight?
Three legs?
Yes,
steel
legs. Steel legs?
Yeah.
Steel legs in what manner? I mean.
Well, I noticed in some of the pictures you have your figures not solid.
Oh, yeah.
But raised up.
Yeah.
Legs.
Well, those small things that I was showing you, that's really just, I was designing something for somebody who wanted something for a garden. So instead of having it on the ground down there, they could have it up there in the greenery as if it was floating. So it's purely, I mean, it's really just the feel you need to get. If you want something that's a bit more uplifted in its feeling, then slender legs that will disappear. That's one solution. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you work on lots of pieces at one time?
Yeah.
You figure one and start another one.
Yeah. Yeah. Always. They're always a million on the go. Not a million, that's a lie. A few. And some people are there to help me finish them. And so, because I get to the end, I always get to the end, and then I go, okay, that's finished, and it isn't. You know, so just bringing them home at the end is, you know, take something, because I'm already over it, I'm already finished, you know.
Sorry.
Have you had pieces that you've been commissioned that you did not want to let go of, that you want to keep it, hide it in the bedrooms?
The question was, have I had pieces that I haven't wanted to let go of? They always, I like to let them go because I want them to go and have lives of their own. You know, so that's kind of off you go.
Like your kids,
yeah. But I do notice, so let's say the one that, you know, we've got now in the Shire offices, I had it in the garden for quite a long time, to, you know, storage in the garden. And so I got to watch it when the wind blew, it turned, and I really, really loved it in the garden. And when it came for it to go to live in the Shire offices, I'm like, oh, that's not right, you know. So I really didn't, because it was so lovely in the garden and it had its own life. It's just beautiful. So it's almost better that I don't have them, because I get attached to them, you know, and you start to really love them more.
Like children.
Like children. So you want them all to go off and live with other people.
Will it live outdoors? No,
it's not living outdoors.
It's not going to be able to.
No, you'll have
wind.
To go and
push it.
Wait for it not looking. Wait for Grace to not look. Give it a little push. Yeah, I know.
Ducks might get stiff.
Yeah, they might get stiff.
Perhaps time for two more questions?
Yeah.
Do you ever begin a piece and not finish, or do you always work from a model, a small scale, and so they're all intended to be made? Does that make sense?
Yeah. So the question is, do I finish all the pieces, or do they always start as models and then get finished? I mostly don't have models. No, I just go and just start. But sometimes I'll have a shape that isn't right. I might have started it and then I'll think that's not right. Or sometimes you have ones that you turn upside down and you think it looks better upside down. You know, in fact, we had a piece that was called Trojan Bunny, which had ears that went out this way. Now, it started off as a beak. It had three legs and a body and a head. It looked like a beak. And then I think somebody said, that looks like a rabbit. And I said, no, it doesn't. And then it became a rabbit. So, you know, or you could cut bits off with fiberglass. It's fantastic. You know, you can cut bits off and you can put bits on and read. So you can do lots of things. Yeah. So nothing gets to the end of the process if I'm not happy with it. If I'm not happy with it, you can do a million things with it. Yeah.
I think that's a good answer. Thank you.
Yep.
Hi, Deborah. I was just going to ask, where does your main inspiration come from? As in, do you find being in a particular place helps to inspire you to create? You just find the thoughts just continue to come.
So this is a question about inspiration. Where do I need to be? Probably in the studio is good. That helps. But not always. Not always. Sometimes being away from the studio is good because your thoughts can really just go where they go. I'm inspired by everything. And I don't mean that facetiously, but I mean, you know, I went up to Swan Hill and they've got this giant rainbow trout. It's giant rainbow trout. And I thought, wow, I'd love to make a giant something, you know. And I start to look at it and see, how did they make this? You know, so I'm like that. I went to the Picasso exhibition in Sydney, whenever it was, last year. And it just blew my mind. I mean, I love Picasso, that's kind of obvious, and I'm inspired by him. But, you know, I look at the work, and I'm like, oh. I can't, it's almost like every cell in my body gets energised and go, oh, got to get out of here and do something. You know, I get so excited. So, you know, the bronzes and the paintings and the, you know, thing. I mean, it just blows my mind. Or, you know, just there's so much. There's so much that is inspiring. Or, you know, you hear a bit of music that's just incredible. Or, you know, you listen to the science show. And the other day they were talking about nothing. The four different kinds of nothing. I'm like, oh, that's mind-blowing. But, you know, that's really, it's just everywhere. It's just everywhere. So there's no place that isn't. But as I say, to actually make the work, it's good to get into the studio because I can easily not do that. Yeah.
How do you come up with the names for your pieces? Do you start off with the name or your name value finished?
Names. This is a naming question. The names come in all sorts of funny ways. I think Big Kitty
think Lynn named Big Kitty. So, you know, we thought, that's a good name. Look, the only thing I've ever really named that I've had to change was Ship of Fools, because I... I thought it was Pussy and Pussy. Pussy's still a good name.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But, no, I'll take a name from anywhere if it's a good one. I don't like
working
one.
Names.
Working, that's right, we have working names.
So you sort of work, name them as you're going along, or after you finish the piece, or...
Oh, it can happen any time. You can have an in-studio name, which is, you know, Blue Dog, because it's blue, you know, and then you get it into the studio, into the gallery, and it, you know, might have get some other name, like Harriet or something. You know, that's happening. Names are like, you know, inspiration. It can happen at any time.
Deborah?
Yeah.
You know, the glass pieces that you were looking at before, and I asked you, you know, was it painted, and you said you cut them.
Mm.
How do you join them? They didn't look like they had...
Because it's fused.
It's fused.
It's fused glass. This is a question about the glass. So it's fused... So the glass is cut. It's all the glass is compatible, so it all expands at the same rate. And you cut it with a glass cutter, but you have to cut it... To fit. And when it goes into the kiln, you get it to, it has a certain...
You heat it up.
Yeah, so then it melts, and then it melts, and then you don't do it too much or it'll just melt everywhere.
Yeah, yeah.
You stop it at a certain point.
I get it now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Good, pleasure.
Perhaps one very last one. The gentleman in the centre here.
Say don't listen to anyone. But that might go badly for you. Look, my advice probably would more be for teachers, to tell you the truth, which would be to keep listening for what's inspiring those kids and kind of get yourself out of the way. Because I know for myself as a teenager, I didn't want people to tell me what to do. Oh, I'm still a bit like that. I didn't want people to do it. I wanted my thoughts to be mine. They're like precious, you know. So whilst listening for what's inspiring this kid, because the thing is, we don't know what's available in every person. Do you know what I mean? I mean, I might think, oh, that kid, they should do blah, 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 blah. Well, then that's my idea about that kid. But we want that kid's full self-expression. So it's just like getting yourself out of the way and opening it up and what do they need. And I suppose for kids, as with most creative people, you want them to have the experience of completing something so that they have something to show. Do you know what I mean? Because you can go on looking and looking forever, then you just end up with a lot of looking. But, you know, I could talk about this forever, so we could talk later if you like.
I think that's a lovely place to leave it. On behalf of Montalvat and Nilambic Shire Council, thank you so much, Deborah.
Thanks.
It's been an absolute pleasure and an inspiration.
Thank you.